walking in sunlight all of my journey over the mountain to the banquet bed. Jesus has said, Revival, people immediately say, well, who was Melchizedek?
Actually, that's not the point of the story. What is the point of the story was, Melchizedek was a high priest of God. No genealogy is given of him. Nothing about a birth, nothing about a death, nothing about parents, nothing about descendants. All we know of Melchizedek, he was alive. No emphasis that he inherited his priesthood from someone else. So all we can know that he had it from God, and all we have to look at that he was worthy of it himself. So now when Abraham met him and gave him the tithes, Melchizedek blessed Abraham. 7th chapter of Hebrews, if you want to check me out on this. Melchizedek blessed Abraham, and in doing so, Paul said, the less is blessed of the better, establishing the fact that Melchizedek was superior to Abraham. That catches a lot of people, I think, by surprise, but that's the way it was. Now, when Abraham paid tithes to Melchizedek, since the Levitical priesthood inherited their job from their parent father, each man was a priest, his ancestry was priest, he was given his priest by, we could say, genealogy. Well, there's no indication that Melchizedek's priesthood came that way. There's no indication he passed it on to his children. We find him a living priest. We find no death records. Now, irregardless of who you want to think Melchizedek was, I just say myself, I don't believe he had no genealogy record. I don't believe there was no record where he inherited it or where he passed it on. I honestly believe he was a normal man, except he was a priest of God. But some people say he was Shem. Some people say he was Jesus. Some people said he was an angel. But irregardless, the story here is to establish a fact. The fact is Melchizedek was superior to Abraham. Now, Jesus was a high priest of the New Testament. But under the law, he could not be a priest because he was not of the tribe of Levi. He was the tribe of Judah. So therefore, when a change in the priesthood required a change in the covenant. Now, when we look at it like this, how are we going to rate the priesthood of Christ with that of the Levites? Well, since Abraham paid tithes to Melchizedek, if you look at that on a genealogy level, Levi paid tithes in Abraham to Melchizedek, showing the Melchizedek's priesthood was superior to that of Levi. I go through all this. 8th chapter of St. John. The Jews begin to dispute with Christ about who he was. They begin to question and say, who are you, man? I'm going to put it in my language, you know. Who are you? Who do you think you are? And then they go on down to the 53rd verse of that chapter, and they say, well, art thou greater than our father Abraham?
Which is dead.
We would say, who do you think you are? You really think you're greater than Abraham? Point was, he was greater than Abraham.
Amen.
Now, had those Christians in Paul's day not had Paul there to straighten them out, Jesus would come in under Abraham, Moses, and the major prophets. Jesus would have wound up being about number 4 as a minor prophet. But Paul said, no, this is wrong. This is wrong. Since Melchizedek was superior to Abraham, superior to the Levitical priesthood. Jesus, God swore Jesus to the priest forever after the order of Melchizedek, showing Jesus was superior to Abraham. You know, well, the Jews made a big issue of it. They said, we have Abraham to our father. In other words, well, we're so great. And our blood flows the blood of Abraham, and we're so great that the Gentile is just a dog. He don't count for nothing. Well, that superiority is still being taught among the Christian churches. I hope I don't hurt nobody's feelings. I don't mean to. We're still teaching a lot of Christians that the Jew is better than us. Because one of these days, God's going to save every Jew, but he's only going to save a part of the Gentiles. All Israel's going to be saved, they teach, yet for the future. They're still teaching, they're still adept in some of the Pharisee teachings, that all, because they're descended from Jacob, they're going to be saved. They ain't got no choice, it's predestinated that they're going to get saved. Now I would invite anybody to look back where they get those 7 years and show me whether there's a break between the 69th and 70th week of Daniel's prophecy. All teachings that teach this mostly, it happens after the rapture. God's going to move back and make a covenant with Israel, and he's going to save every one of them. Well, then they go to go out and get saved a few hundred million Gentiles, not all of them, but a few hundred million of them. Implying that these Jewish people, without the use of the Spirit of God, will get more people saved than the church did for 2,000 years with the anointing of the Holy Ghost working in their lives. Quite superior people. When you really think about what they're teaching, you go up to certain Baptist churches, go to certain Pentecostal churches, you go to certain Methodist churches, certain Holiness churches, and they won't explain it out, but that's actually what they're teaching. Now then, but Jesus is not below Abraham. I am the seed of Abraham and heirs according to the promise. But why? Because I belong to Christ. The qualification there is not Abraham, it's Christ. My faith is in the Lord Jesus Christ, and therefore, because of that, I am classified as a seed of Abraham and heirs according to promise. Why am I classified according to his seed? Because he was a man that God first called out and separated himself unto a walk of faith. There were men before him that believed God, but God said, come out from among your kindred. That's the first record we have of anybody being called out from among their kindred and said, I'll send you to a country. You're on your way now. I'm going to put you on a journey. He walked by faith. So we got what? We got saved. And the Lord says, come on, separate yourself from your former environment. Now, abstain from all appearance of evil. Now, watch and pray that you enter not into temptation. You're walking a different line. You're on your way to, you know, what's the old song? To Canaan's land, I'm on my way. This is symbolic usage of the land of Canaan. We're on our way to heaven, but this is the way we're using the land, Canaan's land, all symbolically to show that we're walking the same path that Abraham. Abraham walked it by faith, but he walked it much in the natural. We walk in the spiritual walk. Only because we belong to Jesus Christ. Now then, if I, because I am a Christian, am the seed of Abraham, but this Gentile over here who is not a Christian, he's not Abraham's seed, how is it that an ungodly, raunchy, filthy Jew is still the same level I am? His blood makes him better than this sinful Gentile? Actually, it don't. They're both in the same boat. They either saved or they're lost. They either believe or they don't believe. They're both in the same boat. Jesus is superior. Now that we baptize in water, not because of John the Baptist. We baptize in water because Jesus told us to. I'm sure when Matthew was in, I think he went to Iraq, didn't he? Mm-hmm. I'm sure he was in Iraq. There was time David got down and said, Lord, please take care of my boy. See, David still got a little bit of that little bitty boy in his heart. And he'll never get gone. You know, I don't care how big and strong and Matthew gets, there's still a little something there that says, my little boy.
Amen.
Lord, please. Say, my little boy, I want you to do it in the name of you, Mary. I want you to do it in the name of John. Moses, Abraham, I want to please, Lord, in the name of Jesus. We have no access to God other than the name of Jesus. How was it Stevie said it here the other day? I forget all of it. I can't quote him. Some say that somebody said Jesus was a way of salvation.
Oprah Winfrey.
He wasn't a door. No, he is the door. Mm-hmm. See, Jesus says, I am the door. And besides me, if anybody come any other way, the same as a
thief and a robber.
Amen. If you go through Mary, you're a thief and a robber.
That's right.
If you go through Moses, you're a thief and a robber. If you go through Muhammad, see, now this is the warfare we are facing. There might come a day you may have to give your life for this belief. Jesus is the only door to God there is. What the world wants us to say, they want us to bring Jesus down to a minor level. He's a prophet, all right. Yeah,
good guy.
But he's just one other door. He's just one among them. Build your own door. You can still go through. This is what they're demanding that we say. No matter what walk you walk, there's a door there for you. You don't have to go through Jesus. This is the thing where the Christian separates off. We can't mix in acceptance of the world. We must accept only access through Christ. And this thing now, how important this is. In the early days of the church, according to Christian history, sometimes Christians would get called up. The Romans rated Caesar as a god. They got a little thing of, I mean, I don't have an exact description, you know, a little brazen thing of fire here, in here. Now, all this Christian had to do, take a little incense, this is burnt to Caesar, drop it in it, and he could live. But rather than drop that incense into that fire, they would raise their hand and say, only Christ is the Lord. And they would die rather than drop that in. Men, you cannot recognize any other door. Jesus is the door. Jesus is superior to Abraham. Before Abraham was, Jesus said, I am.
Yep.
Jesus existed before he became flesh and dwelt on this earth. He was superior to Abraham. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. In the beginning, Jesus was the divine purpose of God for the salvation of mankind. He was with the Father in the beginning. What was before that? Eternity. Beyond that, I don't know, and I don't have to know. Jesus died for me on the cross, and I'm going to be saved.
Yep.
That is all I have to know. There's many things I can't answer, but it is this. There is no door other than Jesus. And this is a very important scripture. I know I'm going on and on and on about it, but this is a very important scripture in that it shows the superiority of Jesus to all other men. You know, they say, well, hey, I have Abraham as a father. I got a special point because I'm absolutely descended from Abraham. Well, what does our covenant say? For God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever should believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. One of the most common scriptures taught among our people today. You go to Sunday school, and they got them little cards you give little children, that's one of the first Bible verses they give to them. That is our covenant. That's our claim to salvation. If you believe in Jesus, you shall be saved. Paul said in the 10th chapter of Romans, if you confess the Lord Jesus with his mouth and believe it in your heart, you shall be saved. Certain people says if you join this church, if you baptize in water in this name, if you baptize in water, if you acknowledge this, no. The only qualification to get saved is confess the Lord Jesus Christ in his doctrine, you with your mouth, and believe it in your heart, you shall be saved. That scripture says whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Obligation there is, salvation's not just for the Jew, salvation is also for the Gentile, whosoever he is. Many of our people have taken that statement and put it after the rapture of the church, when the Spirit's gone, just say, Lord, save me. Jesus said, no man can come unto me except my Father which sent me draw him.
Yeah.
Stephen preached, he said, there is no conversion without conviction. That's the same statement. No man can come unto me except my Father which sent me draw him. If the Spirit was taken out of the world, the Holy Ghost, church is gone, I just say, Lord, save me. And I'm saved on my own merit now. Spirit ain't drawing me. Church is gone. When Romans 6, when you're baptized into Christ, you're baptized into his body. By one Spirit, 1 Corinthians 12:13, by one Spirit we're baptized into one body. Now, do I teach baptism is essential? Yeah, baptism into Christ, which is a spiritual act conducted by the Holy Ghost. When you theoretically come up here and you get on your knees, you begin to cry out, Lord, and the Lord forgives you. See, I didn't save myself. Christ ain't on a nail back there. I can't come in and reach up and get him off the wall. Amen. I've done that, you know, I think. But when the Lord says, come, come, I'll save you. I raise my hand towards heaven and say, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. The Holy Ghost comes by, I can't save myself. I ain't got the ability, but the Holy Ghost comes by, and because of God's loving grace, he baptizes me into the church, the body of Christ. Ain't a preacher in the world had anything to do with working in the church, except he could preach the gospel to me. See, if the preacher could put you in the church, that's why they had infant baptism. Because they've done away with the altar, now they give it into the hands of a man, and he baptizes the baby, and he's automatically a church member. You don't got to go to the altar. Unfortunately, a lot of them never get saved.
Yeah. Well, if I've got to start doing that, then I'd raise my salary. That's all.
Sometimes Steve says stuff like that, it's probably good I can't hear. Listen, it's important we put Jesus in his proper place. I am not Jesus only. There probably ain't a person in Monroe County any harder against that doctrine than I am. I definitely believe there is a Father that Jesus prayed to in heaven while he was standing on the earth.
Amen.
And I believe when he was baptized, he came up out of the water, he stood in the water. And the Spirit of God, the Holy Ghost, come down.
Amen.
And abode on him in the shape of a dove.
Amen.
And God testified from heaven and said, this is my son, in whom I'm well pleased.
Yeah.
To Jesus only did I the record God gave of his son. He did not say, this is me. He said, this is my son.
Yeah.
They deny this record because they believe the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost is one and the same individual. Therefore, they put the Father on the cross. They put the Holy Ghost on the cross. Because if Jesus is all three, then Jesus went to the cross. So they won't acknowledge and agree with that I said what I said, but in reality they do. If Jesus died on the cross and he's all there is, then all there is died on the cross. Well, Melchizedek plus Abraham. The purpose of this story is to show the superiority of Christ to the Levitical priesthood, to Moses, and even to Abraham himself. Believe whatever you want to about who Melchizedek was. I believe he was a normal man, just he had no genealogy record. But it doesn't matter who he was superior to Abraham. And when Abraham paid tithes to him, he acknowledged his superiority. When Melchizedek blessed Abraham, the less is blessed of the better, 7th chapter of Hebrews. Therefore, the Bible acknowledges Melchizedek to be superior to Abraham. And when God declared Christ to be a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek, he personally told the Jewish people, Jesus is superior to Abraham. Now, I believe Abraham was a great man. I believe Mary was a great woman. But neither one of them is the mediator between God and man. This is the thing about we are in a warfare spiritually. We are being demanded to accept multiple mediators. Make whoever you want to be the mediator, and society is demanding we not only tolerate, it's not about tolerance, it's about acceptance and approval. They are demanding that you agree that that's right. They're not demanding that we tolerate the Muslim. In America, we do. What they're demanding is we say that is okay. Muhammad is adored just like Jesus. You know what we've done? We took God's testimony of Jesus and we brought it down here. We put Muhammad at least equal with him. We put Moses equal with him. We put Abraham equal with him. We put Buddha equal with him. We put Confucius equal. Think about it, we just built a whole bunch of doors. And they're saying you must acknowledge these doors also. And I pray God gives us the strength that if we have to, we die before we do that. Now, I'm not tough, no. But I do believe there's a grace in God to get in your heart and give you the strength to stand whatever comes your way.
Brother Johnson, you know, it's pretty hypocritical in their thinking, because while they're not willing to give up what they believe, you know, they'll tell them, they expect that of
us. Demand us to.
You know, we're not the only ones that are exclusive when it comes to saying Christ is the Messiah. They'll tell you without, you know, whether it's the Mormons or the Muhammads or whatever, you know, they learn that their way is their only way, you know. But they get mad at the Christians because, you know, this nation, you know, the foundation of it and everything else was built on the principles, you know, that come from that book, and it doesn't lift up any of it. It doesn't accommodate them, right. But now, like he said, they don't want to be accommodated, they want to be celebrated. And not just tolerated anymore. They want us to, like you said, raise them up. But in order to do that, we have to forsake the principle of this book.
Right?
They demand that you put your approval on it and tell everybody that's fine. They demand, it's the same thing with sexual perversion that's going on in America, where the women murder their babies, or two men getting married. They're not about tolerance. They demand you say it's okay, that it's good. See, the time has come when they are demanding that you say evil is good and good is evil.
Yeah.
Now, good is to stand up and say you must be born again, like Stevie's been preaching here. You've got to accept Jesus Christ. There has to be a change in your life. That's good.
Paul said in Romans, remember, serves me right, to not let your, how's that worded, not your good be evil spoken of, not render evil for good or good for evil. These same encounters, maybe on a different scale, Paul encountered back then.
Yeah.
So it's nothing new, it's just maybe on a different scale.
Right.
It was a battle there, and it was a great battle. And the same battle's going on in the churches. Now, be merciful toward me. But the man that gets up here and tells you that the Jew is going to get saved because he's a Jew, and the Gentile, only a portion of us going to get saved, is a man that is denying John 3:16.
Amen.
Everybody everybody that believes is guaranteed salvation. Everybody that does what God said do, they're guaranteed salvation. I can't hold it from back from nobody. A Jewish man down there, a black man, Asian, Native American, they don't care who he is. If in his heart he believes the gospel, cries out for salvation, God will save him.
Yeah.
I can think whatever I want about it. God has done. Well, Janice, sure, she'd be frowning at me. God has done predestinated that man will get saved if he will meet that standard.
Yeah.
And he's also told us that he won't pray. It's a predestinated thing, meaning you can't change it. He's going to hell. So, do I believe in some of Brad Paul's predestination? Up to a point. I just don't believe that God predestinated that I have to go to hell.
Amen.
I believe God predestinated that if I will repent, that I can go to heaven.
My mom and dad, okay, on their side of the family, my mom's family, almost every one of them I know is just old-time missionary Baptist, primitive Baptist, or anything like that, and they were believers. They grew up with it, okay? Now, my dad's side of the family, they all have heard the word. Almost every one of them has been in church, heard the word, heard the preaching, but they won't accept it. That's exactly what you're saying. So was it predestinated that my mom's side of the family will all be saved, and my dad's side, they're all going to die lost? It's what you do with it. Amen.
That's right.
It's what, you know.
Your choice determines what happens. The rules are there. Then you choose which rule you follow.
Tina Turner, the famous rock singer, whatever, she's Buddhist. And they asked her one time, they interviewed her, they said, well, why do you practice Buddhism? She said, because I decide what's right and wrong. Not Terry, not the preacher, not you, and not this. I decide what's right and wrong. Brother Stevie, I don't have the ability to do that, amen? I don't.
No, there are absolutes. To those people, there's no absolutes. There's no, to them, if you really look at it, there is no absolute door. And they become upset when we say there is, and it's Jesus.
I got a question on this, because I had something happen to me last night. I went to text a friend of mine that lives over here. He's an ordained minister, you know, he's married people and stuff. He's got a certification and all that. So I went to go text him last night, and it wasn't him no more. Somehow he must have changed his number or something. But the person that I was texting said their name was Tim. T-I-M. And I thought it was a guy. Well, come to find out, it wasn't even a guy. It was a woman. And her name was Tamira. So I get further on, and, you know, I apologize for calling her out of who she was. You know, I thought she was a man. Turned out to be she's a woman, so I apologize for that. Because I said, brother. I said, I'm sorry, brother. And then that's when I found out she was a woman. So I said, okay, I apologize. I did not mean to offend you. I'm sorry, sister in Christ. Oh, that even offended her even worse. I mean, straight offended her. She come back with this long message talking about she don't worship Christ. She worships Allah. I mean,
but that's where it's at.
It got so deep that I just had to let go of the whole conversation and say, and let her know that, you know, I really did not mean to offend you. But yet, she called me a foolish American because I'm believing in Christ.
You're an offense because you exist.
You know what I'm saying? And now we're talking about it, it's like, how did that come about? You know what I'm saying? And it had to be Christ. It had to be Him to let me know. The thing, we are in that spiritual warfare as is being told. That was my confirmation last night to me.
You know, when Jesus came along, they had a hard time accepting people too. People put faith in almost anything other than Christ. Paul said in Hebrews, for the priesthood being changed, there is made there is made of necessity a change also of the law, because Jesus could not be a priest under the law, being of the tribe of Judah. For being these sayings are spoken pertaining to another tribe, which of which no man give attendance at the altar, for it is evident that our Lord sprang out of Judah, of which the Moses spoke nothing concerning priesthood. And it is yet far more evident, for that after the similitudes of Melchizedek, there arises another priest, who's made not after the law of the court of commandment, but after the power of endless life. For he testified, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Now, as far as our Bible teaches us, we only see Melchizedek as a living man. We don't see a record of his death. Nothing but a living priest. The Levitical priesthood, by the structure, testified of their death. Each man death, one come on, replaced him. He gave the priesthood over to his son. His son become a priest after him, his son after him. But with Melchizedek, there's no record of it. The only thing you can see of Melchizedek is he lived. Now, I didn't say that to make him a supernatural being. I just said the only record you have of him, that he was a living priest. You have no record of his inheritance. So Jesus is a high priest forever after the similitude of Melchizedek. See, Jesus lives forever. He's always a living priest. The Levites died and replaced, and died and replaced, passing on from generation to generation. Our high priest died once. Being the high priest, he offered sacrifices for the sins of the people one time. Contradicting the Catholic doctrine of when the Lord's Supper, that they re-sacrifice Christ. They teach, and there's a great warfare back in the churches about this giving out the Lord's Supper, that this really was, the sacrifice of the Lord. He's been sacrificed several million times or billion times, if this would be true. But Jesus was sacrificed once
and for all.
And his sacrifice was perfect. Therefore, there was never any need to repeat. The sacrifice under the law only lasted temporarily. And the high priest's point, 1 year. Because it couldn't really do the job. So it was done in faith, looking forward to the sacrifice that could do the job. Last week, Stevie mentioned something. He said Noah was perfect. Then he said, because he perfectly obeyed God. Someone asked you a question. You answered to yourself. Don't. Put me on the spot. You got saved. God forgive you everything you've ever done. Nothing against you. You're white as snow. God doesn't forgive you. And you walk down through this life and you're doing your best to be a Christian. What does God see when he looks at you? With that, my time is up.